Our Heavenly Father, it is to you that we come in Jesus' name, recognizing our desperate need of your Spirit, recognizing our weakness and our emptiness and our insufficiency to do even the least for you. But we thank you so much, Father, that you bear with us and you bear long. But we ask for the outpouring of your Holy Spirit. And as we have our study today together, Lord, may it not just be another meeting or another camp meeting as a whole, but may it be the meeting that will hasten the return of Christ, to which we will never again see a camp meeting on this earth, but be joined together in the great camp meeting above. Amen. So we commit ourselves into your hand at this moment. Bind every hindrance or obstacle to your work, I ask. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Good afternoon, brothers and sisters.
Good afternoon.
I'm already 13 minutes ahead of where I should say behind, so I want to go ahead and begin in the presentation that I have set for today. As you see, based upon the screen here, because of the theme of this year's camp meeting, prepare for the end, I thought that it would be well to look at some things concerning the end of all things. How many of you believe that we are at the end of all things?
Amen.
Brothers and sisters, we are.
Yes.
And I tell you, this thought has been so much more impressed upon me over the last several months, or maybe year now. As we see things that are developing in society, we recognize that the end of all things is at hand. And I want to begin with that passage in 1 Peter. And I have most of the scriptures on the screen because I knew that I would have a certain amount of time and I did not want to waste any time. Not saying that opening the Bible is a waste of time, but to make it efficient as possible. So you can take notes if you would prefer, but I have all the scriptures that I'm going to be referring to, I have on the screen for you. But we're going to begin in 1 Peter chapter 4. 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 7, in which we read the following, and I hope this is legible. It's kind of short, small coming on the screen here. But Peter says, "But the end of all things is at hand. Be ye therefore what? Sober, in the right state of mind, and watch unto prayer." So Peter says, the end of all things is at hand. Now, if that was the case 2,000 years ago, if the end of all things was at hand, or in other words, within your reach, how much more are we close to the end of all things 2,000 years later? It's so much close that you can not only touch it, but you can grasp it. You can surround your arms around it. That's how close we are to the end of all things. In Matthew chapter 24 and verse 3 and onward, we know the account in which the disciples, they leaving the temple, and they began to show Jesus the beauty and the wonderful stones of the temple building. And Jesus said something to them that struck odd with them, with his disciples. And his disciples pondered about what it is that Jesus meant. And so it says here in Matthew 24:3, as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, "Tell us, when shall these things be?" Concerning the things that Jesus had just mentioned, not one stone remaining upon another that shall not be cast down. When shall these things be? And what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the what?
The world.
So the disciples wanted to know, and you see how they connected the destruction of the temple in Jerusalem with the end of the world. They did not understand the difference. Nonetheless, the question is very critical. When shall these things be? What is the sign of your coming and of the end of the world? And of course, Jesus began to give them various things in which they can look forward to concerning the end. And Jesus said, answered and said unto them, "Take heed that no man deceive you." For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in diverse places. And then he goes on to say that these are just the beginnings of sorrow, the beginnings of pains, of plagues. These are just the beginnings of them. So Jesus talked about nations rising against nations, and it doesn't take a rocket science to figure this out. In World War I, we saw approximately 20 million people died as a result of World War I. And World War II was even two times more. We saw three times more. 60 to 90 million people lost their lives in World War II. And then we had the Vietnam War, the Gulf War, the war in Iraq, and now we have what is termed the War on Terror. There has always been wars. And Jesus says that nation will rise against nation. He also mentioned about famines being a significant part of the last days. Right now we have approximately 40 countries suffering from a shortage of food, primarily in India and in places like Africa and South America. 40 countries suffering from a shortage of food. And it estimates to be around 57 million people die every year from starvation. And of course, those type of statistics we do not recognize here in America, because we have an abundance of bread, fullness of pride and idleness, as it says in Ezekiel. But 57 million people are perishing yearly from a want of food. Famines are everywhere. Pestilences, Jesus says, will be in the last days. And we have these new plagues and pestilences that plague society: malaria, tuberculosis, Ebola, syphilis, and others. Plagues that Jesus said would be widespread epidemic diseases and sicknesses. Jesus also mentioned earthquakes would be in the last days, and today they measure about 6,000 major earthquakes take place on a yearly basis. And they classify the major ones as, I believe, those that are 4.8 magnitude or greater. At least 6,000 major earthquakes happen each year. Now, on April 25th of this year, 2015, approximately 4,000 people lost their lives when a 7.8 magnitude earthquake hit Nepal's capital city of Kathmandu and its surrounding areas. And the earthquake was then followed by a large number of aftershocks, including one that measured to be 7.3 magnitude on May 12th. Earthquakes are still abounding. This is from Inspiration 6T, page 408, in which we read, the restraining spirit of God is even now being withdrawn from the world. Hurricanes, storms, tempests, fire and flood, disasters by sea and land follow each other in quick succession. Science seeks to explain all these, the signs thickening around us, telling of the near approach of the Son of God, are attributed to any other than the true cause. Men cannot discern the sentinel angels restraining the four winds, that they shall not blow until the servants of God are sealed. But when God shall bid his angels loose the four winds, there will be such a scene of strife as no pen can picture. Right. Again, these are just the beginning of sorrows that we are dealing with today. Amen. Another quotation from Inspiration, Maranatha 37, the Lord will arise to shake terribly the earth. We see troubles on all sides. Thousands of ships will be hurled into the depths of the sea. These are prophecies here. Navies will go down, and human lives will be sacrificed by the millions. Fires will break out unexpectedly, and no human effort will be able to quench them. The palaces of earth will be swept away in the fury of the flames. Disasters by rail will become more and more frequent. Confusion, collision, and death without a moment's warning will occur on the great lines of travel. The end is near. Probation is closing. What about the moral conditions at the end of time? Jesus says in Matthew 24:37, but as the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. Now we know this quite well. What was the moral condition of society in Noah's day, which would have its parallel to our time? Genesis 6:1-2 says, and it came to pass, when men began to multiply on the face of the earth, and daughters were born unto them, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men, that they were fair, and they took them wives of all which they chose. And the Lord said, my spirit shall not always strive with man, for that he is also flesh. Yet his days shall be 120 years. There were giants in the earth in those days, and also after that, when the sons of God, that is the descendants of Seth, came in unto the daughters of men, and they bare children to them. The same became mighty men which were of old, men of renown. The earth, in verse 11 and 12 says, the earth also was corrupt before God, and the earth was filled with what? Violence. And God looked upon the earth, and behold, it was corrupt, for all flesh had corrupted his way upon the earth. And God said to Noah, the end of all flesh is come before me. You see, this happened before, when God proclaimed that there would be an end to the first world. God said the end to Noah, he said, the end of all flesh has come before me. And brothers and sisters, that is what he is saying to us today. The end has come before God. And what did he tell Noah? He says, for the earth is filled with violence through them. And behold, I will destroy them with the earth. Now let's magnify this to see what inspiration has to help us to understand the moral conditions in the days of Noah. We're told in Patriarchs and Prophets 97, they continued their festivities and their gluttonous feasts. They ate and drank, planted and builded, laying their plans in reference to advantages they hoped to gain in the future. And they went to greater lengths in wickedness and in defiant disregard of God's requirements to testify that they had no fear of the Infinite One. So this is a look at the attitude of those men in the days of Noah. They continued their festivities, their gluttonous feasts. They continued to eat and drink. They continued to plant and build. They continued to lay their plans for the future, all in defiant disregards of God's law. In defiant disregard of his requirements, even went as far as testifying that they did not fear God. She also goes on to say, God did not condemn the Antediluvians for eating and drinking. He had given them the fruits of the earth in great abundance to supply their physical wants. Their sin consisted in taking these gifts without what? Gratitude to the giver, and debasing themselves by indulging appetite without restraint. Again, this is just an insight into the look of the men in the days of Noah. Their sins consisted in taking these gifts without gratitude to the giver. In other words, they had an abundance, but they did not take God into their knowledge, as Paul says in Romans chapter 1. And not only that, but they debased themselves by indulging their appetite. Their belly was their God. Now, how did the Antediluvians disregard, as we read earlier, that they were doing all these things in defiant disregard of God's requirements? So how did they disregard the institution of marriage and the family. Well, let's look at the Bible first of all. It says in Matthew 24:38-39. For as in the days of that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the day that Noah entered into the ark, and knew not until the flood came and took them all away, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. So this doesn't tell us exactly the issue that was behind how they disregarded the institution of marriage in the family. It just says simply that they were marrying and they were being given in marriage. But inspiration clarifies things for us. It was lawful for them to marry. Marriage was in God's order. But marriage was what? Perverted and made to minister to passions. And that's where God had the issue with. They perverted the institution of marriage and made it a means of ministering to their passions. But it goes further. Polygamy they practice. And polygamy had been early introduced contrary to the divine arrangement at the beginning. The Lord gave to Adam one wife, showing his order in that respect. So here we see that they were practicing polygamy. And these things, mind you, were done by law, not just a simple practice. These were things that the state of their days recognized, that the state encouraged. And with this in mind, I want to look at an insight into Satan's most definite way in which he can ruin the image of God in man and thereby cause misery and vice. What is his most definite way to ruin the image of God in men and thereby open the door for more misery and more corruption to spread? Our inspiration tells us it was Satan's studied effort to pervert the marriage institution, to weaken its obligation, and lessen its sacredness. For in no sure way could he deface the image of God in man and open the door to misery and vice. So you see here that Satan studied to pervert this institution that God ordained, to weaken the obligations of that institution and lessen the sacredness, knowing that by doing so he could deface the image of God for man and open the door for misery and vice. Now this is what took place in the days of Noah. But Jesus says, as the days of Noah were, so also shall the coming of the Son of Man be. So then, how is the institution of marriage and the family disregarded today? First of all, consider what Jesus says in Luke. He says, likewise also as it was in the days of who? So not only as it was in the days of Noah, but as it was also in the days of Lot, even thus shall it be in the day when the Son of Man is revealed. Jude says the following. Even as Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities about them in like manner giving themselves over to fornication and going after what kind of flesh? Strange flesh are set forth for an example. The Apostle Paul also wrote about this in Romans chapter 1, in which he says, for this cause God gave them up unto vile affections. For even their women did exchange the natural use into that which is against nature. And likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the women, burned in their lust one toward another. Men with men, working that which is unseemly. Now recall that we read in Genesis that in the days of Noah, the earth was filled with violence and corruption. And there is so much of a link between that violence and corruption and the perversion of the marriage institution. Here we see what was taking place in their day. Inspiration says the following. The sins that called for vengeance upon the antediluvian world exist when? Today. The fear of God is banished from the hearts of men, and his law is treated with indifference and contempt. I just want to share a few articles that I have done in my research as I look into present day trends of how this corruption and how this violence is in our time as it was in the days of Noah. This is from the Moscow Times. Chechen officials called to legalize polygamy stirs social debate. This is from May 19 of this year. Now I just read the highlighted part. High-ranking Chechen officials called today to legalize polygamy in Russia after a local district police chief took a 17-year-old girl as his second wife last week, has prompted soul searching among the Russian population, which remains torn between its relative acceptance of extramarital affairs and its attachment to the legal and social status quo. Now, this city in Russia is predominantly Muslim. And of course, Muslims believe that you can marry more than one wife. Their prophet had more than one wife. But the issue is how polygamy is gaining influence and spreading in our time. Now, this is in Moscow. Have any of you ever heard of a throuple? Anyone ever heard of a throuple? Here's an article from March 9th of this year, The Advance of the Throuple. Now, you know what a couple is, right? A couple is of two individuals. Well, not only do we have the couple, but we now have throuples. This is from Thai. Three Thai men have advertised their marriage on the internet and appeared in Thai media, claiming the distinction of being possibly the first gay men to have a three-way wedding. Now, not only do we have homosexuality here, but we have polygamy joined together. The first one was in Moscow. This was in Thai, but don't think that it's not on our shores as well. This is in Massachusetts. The next marriage redefinition. Massachusetts lesbian throuple expecting their first child. This was an article taken just last month. In other words, we see this increase. And in fact, we know that the United States Supreme Court right now are perplexed. The court is perplexed over polygamy because they're dealing with the case right now concerning same-sex marriage. And the question of polygamy came up, of course. Here's what this justice has said and to the lawyer that is fighting for same-sex marriage, for the bans at least to be taken off of all states, making it legal all over the United States. This judge says, suppose we rule in your favor in this case, and then after that, a group consisting of two men and two women apply for a marriage license. Would there be any ground for denying them? I'm not going to get all into what the arguments were, but this is a question that is beginning to come up as the United States deal with the issue of same-sex marriage, polygamy as well. Here's an article taken just a few days ago, June 4th of 2015. The United States Supreme Court is expected later this month, that is this month, June, expected to rule on whether state bans on same-sex marriage are constitutional. And the conventional wisdom is the court is going to say the bans are unconstitutional, thereby making it unlawful to deny homosexuals a marriage license nationwide. That is to be decided later this month. Here's a case in Wisconsin when they legalized it last year. It says, Wisconsin legalization of gay marriage boosts total 2014 marriages. So as they legalized that, we saw an influx of marriages take place. And the highlighted part, it just says the Health Services Department report that they found an increase of 2,797 marriages from the year before. Again, we just see this increasing, showing that we are at the end of all things. When you begin to disregard God's law, when you begin to lessen the sacredness of his institution, corruption spread and the plagues begin to fall. Not only is this in the States or in the world, but we even say that this Protestant denomination just blessed same-sex marriage. Francis United Protestant Church voted on Sunday to allow pastors to bless same-sex marriages. 2 years after Paris legalized gay nuptials amid protests backed by the majority Roman Catholic Church. So once the state recognizes, the church follows suit. We often talk about this visit that the Pope is going to be making. Pope calls for, this is from the Washington Post, he calls for family resurrection. And although, now notice this mention, this was written in November of last year by Kathleen Parker. She says, and although, and though he's unyielding in his definition of family, a man and a woman joined in marriage, talking of the Pope, he is open to finding ways to include more people in the church who may fall outside of that definition. So we need to somehow make changes or make adjustments. Now, when you say you're open to finding ways, that means you can't find any in the Word. If you have to be open to try to find ways somehow to accept sin. In the same article, she says, the Pope talked not of sin or judgment, but rather of concern for what he characterizes as disruptions in the human ecology. So let's not talk about sin. Let's not talk about judgment. The very things concerning present truth, actually. Rather, let's talk about concern for one another, for the human ecology. Inspiration says, as the time of their probation was closing, the antediluvians gave themselves up to exciting amusements and festivities. While God's servants are giving the message that the end of all is at hand, the world is absorbed in amusements and pleasure seeking. There is a constant round of excitement that causes indifference to God and prevents the people from being impressed by the truths which alone can save them from the coming destruction. This is what's happening today. While we're proclaiming that the end of all things is at hand, the world is absorbed in amusements and excitements and marrying and being given in marriage and planning and planting and building, all to the neglect of preparing for the end. But what about the condition of the churches? Inspiration, of course, tells us what will take place in the last days concerning the fallen churches. Revelation 13 gives insight, and he had power to give life unto the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause that as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. And he causes all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their foreheads, and that no man might buy or sell save he that had the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name. We know this quite well, but let's go straight to inspiration. Concerning what we just read in Revelation, she says, Protestants will work upon who? The rulers of the land to make laws to restore the lost ascendancy of the man of sin. Now again, we're studying about the end of all things, brothers and sisters. And here we're told that the time is going to come when the Protestant ruler, the Protestants are going to work on the rulers of our land, the president, the legislator, the judicial system, to make laws, specifically the legislators, that will restore the lost ascendancy of the man of sin. And then it says, the Roman Catholic principles will be taken under the care and protection of the state. That will happen. And there is a particular front in which we see it taking place. I mentioned this several months ago, an article that I came across. This was published December 18 of 2014 by Common Dreams, in which they said, on moral grounds, Pope push for action on climate change in 2015. Now in this article, this is what they said. Earlier this year, a group of evangelical Christians urged who? Now we read that the Protestants will work upon the rulers of the land, right? To cause them to make laws to restore the lost ascendancy of this man of sin. Here we have in which they were urging President Obama to discuss climate change with the Pope at the Vatican, while another told Florida Governor Rick Scott that climate change was a pro-life issue. Leaders from several different religions encouraged the EPA to regulate carbon dioxide from power plants at the agency's public hearings in July, with some saying that carbon pollution is an affront to God. And of course, in December of last year, these leaders were brought together. And at this time, the main highlight being the role in which the Pope played in bringing the United States and Cuba back into working relations. That was the highlight of this visit, but I'm sure that there were things going on underneath what was published. Again, in this article, we find this. In recent months, the Observer reports, the Pope has argued for a radical new financial and economic system to avoid two things: human inequality and ecological devastation. So first of all, recall the economic restrictions that we read about in Revelation 13. And secondly, notice what they are seeking to avoid: human inequality and natural destructions, natural devastations. This is from the Climate Progress. This was posted June the 3rd of this year, a few weeks ago, in fact, a week ago. On July 16, that's 6 days from today, that's next Tuesday. On July 16, Pope Francis is expected to release an encyclical letter on the environment. The Catholic Church's strongest statement to date on the moral issues associated with climate change. Now notice the next part. By releasing an encyclical on climate change, the Catholic Church isn't involving itself in controversial science. They say rather it's reiterating what a majority of scientists already know, that the climate is changing and that humans are the cause. Now I want you to think about something briefly. To my observation, I would say, I'm not a scientist, but I would say that there are things going on in climate or in nature that have not been going on perhaps 20 or even 25 or 30 years ago. Things are definitely changing. Yes. There are great extremes in weather that we see today. We see hurricanes and tornadoes and different typhoons and cyclones. These things are reaping havoc everywhere. So I cannot deny that there has been a change in the climate. Neither can I deny perhaps that humans are the cause of that. But I want you to notice something. Right now they are saying that humans are the cause. But let me ask you this. What are the humans doing to cause this climate change and hence cause calamities? Harp. What was that?
Harp.
Harp? Okay.
Chemtrails.
Well, I'm going to let inspiration answer this. Because right now, these individuals are not saying it. But we know that eventually this is what they're going to say as far as what the humans are doing to cause this climate change and to bring about the calamities. This is what they say the cause is. Satan puts his interpretation upon events, and they, that is leading men, think, as he would have them, that the calamities which fill the land are a result of Sunday breaking. That's what it's going to boil down to. That's what it's going to come to eventually. Thinking to appease the wrath of God, these influential men make laws enforcing Sunday observance. Friends, the end of all things is at hand. Amen. That's how close we are to this. It is not a coincidence. Inspiration also goes on to say, those who honor the Bible Sabbath will be denounced as enemies of the law and order, as breaking down the moral restraints of society. You are the ones to blame for this, causing anarchy and corruption, and calling down the judgments of God upon the earth. They will be accused of disaffection toward the government.
Is that 592?
Yes, it is. Now, not only will we be falsely accused of being the cause of calamities, but we will also be stripped of all privileges of a free market economy.
Yep.
We read that those who will not receive the mark of the beast will not be able to buy or sell. Friends, we are so close to that time period. Inspiration says the last great conflict and the controversy with Satan. In the last great conflict and the controversy with Satan, those who are loyal to God will see every earthly support cut off. Because they refuse to break his law in obedience to earthly powers, they will be forbidden to buy and sell. She also says hoarded wealth will soon be worthless. So if you're hoarding wealth, it's about to be worthless. When the decree shall go forth that none shall buy or sell except they that have the mark of the beast, very much means will be of no avail. I know a man who recently died, last month actually, in Kansas, who was coming to our church for some time. This man hoarded thousands of dollars and buried them in his yard. And to this day, they have not been able to find where he buried them. They say at least $30,000 was hoarded and buried, but what good is it? When there is a work to get done in spreading the three angels' messages to this perishing, soon coming end world. A recent article that I found, I came across, published by The Week, it says the end of cash. Could that be? Perhaps. There is a perfect storm, and this is from secular writing here. Even they know a storm is coming. A perfect, they say, storm of systemic financial change on the horizon. They see it coming. City Economist says it might be time to abolish cash. The world's central banks have a problem. This is what they publish. The world's mega bank have a problem. And who do you think they're going to listen to solve their problem? Well, I'll tell you who they're going to listen to. Pope Francis to Congress. Capitalism must change. That's going to be his message when he comes here in September. Part of his message. Capitalism must change. This was published in May. Pope Francis will denounce the inequalities of capitalism when he becomes the first pontiff to address Congress on his visit to the United States in September, according to the closest advisor. Capitalism must change. Friends, the end of all things is at hand. That's how close we are. Political analyst and radio talk show host Kyle Kalinske. He gives insight into the current mentality of Americans towards the words and sanctions of the Pope. Now, to my findings, this gentleman is not a Roman Catholic. Perhaps he may be in the line of an agnostic. I'm not for sure, though, but I know he's not a Roman Catholic. But listen to his words. This is a little video I'm going to show you. It's about 2 minutes long or so. Hopefully we get audio.
Judge Napolitano from Fox Business Network wrote a piece in the Washington Times where he's now joined the parade of conservatives slamming the Pope. He continues, "What shall we do about the Pope and economics? We should pray for his faith and understanding and for a return to orthodoxy." You have to understand something. Pope Francis, he spoke about unfettered capitalism. Now, the reality is Jesus was probably a socialist, probably well to the left of socialism. He's the most liberal dude I've ever read in my life. I mean, some of his lines are way to the left of me. And are you ready for the winning fact here? I mean, this shows you how big of a fool Napolitano is. He's a Roman Catholic. Okay, I don't know if you know anything about your own religion here, buddy, but, quote, "Papal infallibility is a dogma of the Catholic Church, which states that, in virtue of the promise of Jesus to Peter, the Pope is preserved from the possibility of error." The Pope is infallible if you are a Roman Catholic. But Trump is a Roman Catholic and he's disagreeing with the Pope. Which means you're disagreeing with something that by definition cannot be wrong. So it's like you're disagreeing with God. Well, you can't disagree with God, Judge. Are you that arrogant? Are you that insane as to tell your own creator, the literal creator of the universe, and the person who determines all that is just and right, you're telling him he's wrong? Well, I demand you apologize and rewrite an article today talking about how who are you in the face of an infallible one, the Pope, and your Lord, to disagree.
So that's just a look at the current trend of thought toward the words and the sanctions of the Pope. He's infallible. Therefore, who are you to disagree with what he says? Now, what is all this? As we have just considered various things taking place in society, much of which I'm sure is not new to you, but I wanted to impress you with the solemn thought that the end of all things is at hand, and here we are playing games. Now, what does all this say for present-day professors of present truth? The end of all things is at hand. Be sober and watch unto prayer. Now, with all the disasters, the deflations, the destructions, with all the confusion bringing a rapid end to all things, what must professed Seventh-day Adventists achieve before the close of human probation? Give me quick feedback. What must we as a people achieve before probation closes?
Perfection of character.
Perfection of character. What else?
Alerting people around us.
Alerting of the people.
Especially the people that don't know.
Okay.
Unity in the work.
A unity in the work.
Is a three angels message.
All right. Well, this is what I want to take us on real quick, and I heard the answer. Jesus, tell us what it is we must achieve. John 17:21, that they all may be one. As thou, Father, art in me, and I in them, that they may be one in us. Amen. That the world may believe that thou hast sent me. That which we must achieve, friends, is a unity of faith and practice. Paul says in 1 Corinthians, now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that ye all speak different things, the same thing, and that there be no divisions among you, but that ye be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. Now, I do not profess to about to do a thorough subject or a study about unity as we try to wrap things up. But I want to just touch on this briefly because it is so critical for us at such a time as this. Inspiration says, in this day with God, we must obtain the measure of grace of Christ that will enable us to dwell together in love and unity in this life, else we can never dwell together in the life to come. I am trying to show our people the need of unity for which Christ prayed. Now, do we as a people have this unity of Christ today? I mean, if you said yes, I would please show me where. I agree with those who said no. We can look abroad across Seventh-day Adventists or those who profess, whether you be in the conference, in the historic movement, independent, whatever you want to call whatever movement, you profess to be Seventh-day Adventists, there is disunity everywhere. How many organizations are out there that profess to believe the teaching of the Bible and the writings of Ellen White? We probably can't even name all the organizations out there, but I'm going to name a few of them. We have the General Conference, of course, of Seventh-day Adventists. There's a Seventh-day Adventist Reform Movement. There's a True and Free Seventh-day Adventist, the Davidian Seventh-day Adventist, and their branch Davidians, Seventh-day Adventist Kinship International, Sabbath Rest Advent Church, General Assembly of Free Seventh-day Adventists, International Association of Free Seventh-day Adventists, Inter-American Global Evangelism of Free Seventh-day Adventists, Creation Seventh-day Adventist Church. And the list can go on and on. All claiming to believe in the Bible, in the writings of Ellen White, but all bearing the fruit of what could appropriately be called confusion. There's no unity among God's professed people. Do we think that we can dwell together in heaven right now when there is so much division and confusion among professed believers? Before we go to heaven, there must first be a unity among God's professed people upon the platform of truth. There is to be no unity on falsehood, on error. This unity can only be achieved upon the platform of truth. But the point that I want to make, friends, is that there must be unity. How will this unity occur? How will it take place? Well, I'm going to go on a brief study with you about some things that I believe that how this unity can occur. Acts 15, verse 1 and 2, we see this issue. And certain men which came down from Judea taught the brethren and said, except ye be circumcised after the manner of Moses, ye cannot be saved. So here they're presenting a salvational issue. If you don't be, or you've not circumcised and begin to keep the law of Moses, you can't be saved. When therefore Paul and Barnabas had no small dissension and disputation with them, they determined that Paul and Barnabas and certain other of them should go up to Jerusalem unto the apostles and elders about this question. And the apostles and elders came together for to consider this matter. So here we had division taking place in a church, dissension and disputations. And it was even salvational in its content. They were saying, if you don't do this, that, there's no salvation in it. But what did they do? They considered that now was a time for these various views to come together to the apostles and elders for a meeting to consider the matter. Inspiration says this concerning it. In the church at Antioch, the consideration of the question of circumcision resulted in much discussion and contention. Finally, the members of the church, fearing that a division among them would be the outcome of continued discussion, decided to send Paul and Barnabas with some responsible men from the church to Jerusalem to lay the matter before the apostles and elders. There they were to meet delegates from the different churches and those who had come to Jerusalem to attend the approaching festivals. Meanwhile, all controversy was to cease until a final decision should be given in the general council. This decision was then to be universally accepted by the different churches throughout the country. The various points involved in the settlement of the main question at issue seemed to present before the council insurmountable difficulties, but the Holy Spirit had in reality already settled the question upon the decision of which seemed to depend the prosperity, if not the very existence, of the Christian church. The Holy Spirit saw good not to impose the ceremonial law on the Gentile converts, and the mind of the apostles regarding this matter was as the mind of the Spirit of God. James presided at the council, and his final decision was, wherefore my sentence is that we trouble not them which from among the Gentiles are turned to God. The council which decided this case was composed of apostles and teachers who had been prominent in raising up the Jewish and Gentile Christian churches, with chosen delegates from various places. Elders from Jerusalem and deputies from Antioch were present, and the most influential churches were represented. The council moved in accordance with the dictates of enlightened judgment and with the dignity of a church established by the divine will. As a result of their deliberations, they all saw that God himself had answered the question at issue by bestowing upon the Gentiles the Holy Ghost. And they realized that it was their part to follow the guidance of the Spirit. This council did not consist merely of everyone who agreed to try to figure out how they themselves can come into unity. This council consisted of those who did not agree to see what God had to say. First of all, I want you to notice the emphasis I placed on the Holy Spirit and influential men. When the leaders of this church, when the leaders of the church, divided as they were, came together to settle matters of faith and practice, it was then that they realized that the Holy Spirit had already settled the matter. Had they not come together, however, they would have continued to grow in disunity. They would have lost the power of the Holy Spirit, and the work of giving the gospel to their generation would have been retarded. Now, something similar to this happened also in the days of Elijah. Now, therefore, in 1 Kings 18, now, therefore, send and gather to me all Israel. This is Elijah speaking here to the king. Gather to me all Israel up unto Mount Carmel, and the prophets of Baal, 450. And the prophets of the groves, 400, which eat at Jezebel's table. So Ahab sent unto all the children of Israel and gathered the prophets together unto Mount Carmel. So here we have another gathering of sides that were at difference. Variances. They brought them together. And it says, and Elijah came unto all the people and said, how long, we read this earlier, how long halt ye between two opinions? If the Lord be God, follow him, but if Baal, then follow him. Then he goes on in his prayer and Elijah says, O Lord, hear me, that this people may know that thou art the Lord God and thou hast turned their heart back again. You see, it was at this meeting, the purpose of which was a reuniting of a apostate people to the God of Israel. And this is what was the burden of Elijah's message here. And then it says, the fire of the Lord fell and consumed the burnt sacrifice. Notice that it wasn't until the leaders of professed Israel, all of Israel, that said, it wasn't until they came together to settle the issue of which God to worship that God signified where his truth was by sending fire. However, just because God signifies what truth is by the power of the Holy Spirit, there will still be those who oppose and resist the evidences of God. Inspiration bears this out. This is going back to that council that took place in Jerusalem. It says the entire body of Christians was not called to vote upon the question. The apostles and elders, and I want to key in on that because it's critical that our various leaders somehow come together seeking for God to settle this issue of disunity. Elsewise, friends, we can try all day long. I guarantee you we're going to be stuck in this world. And here we are at the end of all things. The apostles and elders, men of influence and judgment, framed and issued the decree which was thereupon generally accepted by the Christian churches. Not all, however, was pleased with the decision. There was a faction of ambitious and self-confident brethren who disagreed with it. These men assumed to engage in the work of their own responsibility, so they continued to think that they were preaching and teaching, we did all this in your name, is what they're going to tell Christ. And he's going to say, depart from me. I never knew you. So they came together, it says, they indulged in much murmuring and fault-finding, proposing new plans and seeking to pull down the work of the men whom God had ordained to teach the gospel message. From the first, the church has had such obstacles to meet and ever will have until when? The close of time. So, brothers and sisters, although the Holy Spirit will clearly settle the issues we might have, there will always be those who will still complain, find faults, propose their own plans and even try to pull down the very work that the Holy Spirit ordained and sanctioned. This we will have to meet until the close of time. But at the same time, God will have a united people. Amen. And when we achieve this unity for which Christ prayed, what will we thus be fitted for? And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all that were in the house. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as a fire, and it sat upon each of them. Brothers and sisters, when we achieve the unity for which Christ prays, then and not until then will we receive that fire that comes from heaven and lightens the earth with its glory. And just as the fire signified to Israel who the God of Israel was by sending fire, or just as God signified it, so it will be by the latter rain and the unity that precedes it, that all will know who the God of heaven is and what his truth is for today. But this unity we must pray and labor for if we would partake of that fire that comes from above. We must labor and pray for this unity. Notice that it was after the disciples had come into perfect unity, when they were no longer striving for the highest place, that the Spirit was poured out. They were of one accord, all differences had been put away. When God's people are one in the unity of the Spirit, all of Pharisaism, all of self-righteousness will be expelled from all hearts. The mold of Christ will be upon each individual member of his body, and his people, notice this, his people will be new bottles in which he can pour his new wine. And the new wine will not break the bottles. Now notice that this is actually a reference to the latter rain message. Not until unity among God's professed people is realized that we will be fitted for the new wine, this added power that God wants to give us. Let all Christians put away all dissensions and give themselves to God for the saving of the lost. Let them ask in faith for the promised blessing, and it will come. The outpouring of the Spirit in the days of the apostles was the former rain, and glorious was the result, but the latter rain will be more abundant. Amen. Now notice again the two specific conditions for the latter rain. Unity, and here it even brings out service. Now when will this perfect unity finally be realized among God's people? When can we expect to see that full unity of which Christ prayed? When can we expect to see it? But let me share something with you. This Psalm 133, verse 1, well-known psalm. David says this, "Behold how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity." Now, we often quote this passage in discussing the blessings of unity. But let me ask you this. What was David's life situation that caused him to write this psalm? What was his life situation that caused him to say, "Oh, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to..." What was his situation at the time that caused him to write it? Well, inspiration tells us what his life situation is, what it was. Among the mountains of Judah, David sought refuge from the pursuit of Saul. He made good his escape to the cave of Adullam, a place that, with a small force, he could be held against a large army. And when his brethren and all his father's house heard of it, they went down thither to him. In the cave of Adullam, the family were united in sympathy and affection. The son of Jesse could make melody with voice and harp as he sang, "Behold how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity." He had tasted the bitterness of distrust on the part of his own brothers, and the harmony that had taken the place of discord brought joy to the exile's heart. So it was in the cave of Adullam that this unity was realized. In other words, it was out of persecution and danger that this unity occurred. And this, I believe, is what it's going to take for the remnant to realize that good and pleasant unity as well. It's going to take persecution. It's going to take that storm that is right at the door. Why do I say that? Because inspiration says the following. As trials thicken around us, both separation and unity will be seen in our ranks. So, and this is in the context of, she's discussing the Sunday law and all those issues involved with this. She says, as those trials thicken, there's going to be a separation, and there's going to be a unity as well.
Amen.
More than that, she says, when the storm of persecution really burst upon us, and we read earlier all these statements that shows that it is at hand. It is so near. But when it happens, the true sheep will hear the true shepherd's voice. Self-denying efforts will be put forth to save the lost, and many who have strayed from the fold will come back to follow the great shepherd. The people of God will draw together and present to the enemy a united front. Now notice this, in view of what kind of peril? The common peril. In other words, it's what they have together. In view of the common peril, strife for supremacy will cease. There will be no disputing as to who shall be accounted the greatest. Friends, we are at the end of all things. And now, like never before, the world is ripe for destruction. The Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever should believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Now, friends, we believe this just as Jesus said it. God sent his only begotten Son. But how can we prove to the world that God sent his only begotten Son into this world to save it from sin and destruction? And what is the most convincing argument we can make in behalf of this truth? In the oneness of Christ's church, it will be proved that God sent his only begotten Son into the world. In that unity that we've been discussing. Bible Commentary, Volume 5, unity with Christ establishes a bond of unity with one another. This unity is the most convincing proof to the world of the majesty and virtue of Christ and of his power to save or to take away sin. Again, this is why we stress this unity that we do not recognize today. The divinity of Christ is acknowledged in the unity of the children of God. Again, this is what is at stake here. This is why I mentioned earlier that just as the fire signified to Israel who the God of Israel was, so it will be by the latter rain and by that unity that precedes the latter rain that all will know who the God of heaven is and what his truth is for today. The most convincing argument we can give to the world of Christ's mission is to be found in perfect unity. In proportion to our unity with Christ will be our power to save souls. So again, friends, the end of all things is at hand. We have looked at the conditions of society that Jesus said would be at the end, especially those as it was in the days of Noah. And it is so clear that we are at the end of all things, but God is wanting and waiting for his people. And like I said, I'm not just talking about a unity of just those who are within one camp. We need to recognize that there is a truth and there is only one truth.
Amen.
And we must be united upon that one truth, that one faith. However, we must not think that we can achieve that unity if we only come together with those who believe like we believe. We must learn how to appeal to and how to witness to those who do not believe the same thing, and at the same time, how to come together asking for God to signify by his power what truth is. Elsewise, you're going to find yourself continuing arguing until the end, and when you come up to Christ, he's going to say, depart. This is not going to end by mere argumentation. It's going to end by sincere, deep, earnest prayer and coming together for that unity, asking God. See, we often come together for in meetings, but God does not show up. God does not send that fire. And that it is what we must be praying for, that God to send that fire to signify. And yes, there will still be people who don't believe and who oppose it, but they will be lost as a result. But those who have the truth and those who take hold of it, who receive the latter rain, they're going to go through until the end. And that's what we're praying for. And we'll close now with a word of prayer. Our Father in heaven, thank you again for being patient with us. Wayward though we be, weak though we be, yet in Christ we are more than conquerors. Father, we are pleading that by your grace we can achieve that unity for which your Son, your only begotten Son, prayed for. Recognizing that yes, we must be united upon the platform of truth. But that is not going to be by mere argumentation and preaching, but by earnest prayer and in joining of hand with even those who oppose us, because we desire that they too should be saved. Lord, we just pray that you will show by your power, by that fire, the side in which your people should be on to bring an end to this work. Because as we have just recognized, we are at the end of all things. Therefore, help us to be sober and watch unto prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.